We recognize that some lipids in our diet are solids at room temperature. We generally refer to those as fats, such as butter. On the other hand, other lipids in our diet are liquids at room temperature, such as the olive oil shown here. So what is the chemical difference between these substances that results in one of them being a solid at room temperature and one of them being a liquid at room temperature? In this video, we will address that key question by exploring intermolecular interactions that are present within lipids. Both fats that are solids at room temperature and oils that are liquids at room temperature are rich in triglycerides as well as fatty acids. So differences in functional groups that are present within those molecules aren't the origin of the difference in boiling point and melting point between the two substances. The difference is that generally fats, being solids, have more saturated fatty acids and saturated triglycerides in them than oils, which are liquids with a smaller number of fully saturated molecules present in them. So let's go ahead and write that down. So our solid fats we recognize as being predominantly present with saturated fatty acids and triglycerides. On the other hand, liquid oils have predominantly unsaturated fatty acids and triglycerides present in them, leading to a lower melting point. So why is it the case that liquid oils with unsaturated groups and solid fats with saturated groups have such different melting points? Well, it has to do with intermolecular interactions. Specifically, saturation will allow greater intermolecular interactions compared to unsaturation. And the reason why it allows greater intermolecular interactions is that the molecules are able to pack tightly against one another due to van der Waal interactions of the aliphatic or lipophilic alkyl chain that is present there. On the other hand, unsaturation leads to decreased intermolecular interactions because the packing is looser than is possible with a saturated molecule. So when we think of a saturated molecule, such as a fatty acid, and this would also apply to a triglyceride molecule as well, we have this long zigzag chain here, and these groups can pack and associate tightly, stacking up here, like so, as a schematic to get, as a consequence of this, relatively strong intermolecular interactions across this long carbon chain, or tight packing, in other words. On the other hand, when we are looking at molecules that have instead an alkene group somewhere within the structure, and I'm going to draw a cis alkene group because that's what's present in natural molecules, the presence of that alkene group acts to prevent or impede that tight packing material. And if we were to build molecular models of the saturated fat relative to the unsaturated fat, we would be able to demonstrate this with the molecular model, illustrating that we can pack the molecules more tightly together, demonstrating stronger intermolecular interactions with the saturated chains relative to the unsaturated chain, where that alkene group specifically, by locking the atoms into a specific configuration, prevents them from packing tightly together. And with that reduced extent of intermolecular interactions, the melting point of the molecules drop as well. Hence, why liquid oils, which are enriched in unsaturated fats, have a much lower melting point than solid fats. And we can observe that because at room temperature within our kitchen, we see that typical animal fats are solid at room temperature. Liquid oils, typically derived from plants and enriched in unsaturated fats, are sitting there as liquids instead. So let's look now at how you might encounter this within a problem on an exam or quiz. As one example, you might be asked to rank some selected fatty acids or triglycerides in order from lowest to highest melting point. The same principles apply toward fatty acids as toward triglycerides. Looking at the three fatty acids we're given some key characteristics, specifically the number of carbon atoms, which is the same across all of them. Therefore, we're able to compare apples to apples, so to speak. The number of alkene groups in each one, which is going to be key toward determining the differences in melting point here. And then we are also given information here about the specific location of the unsaturation, or the specific location of the carbon-carbon double bonds, in other words, where in the molecule has two carbon-carbon double bonds, we're told where those two carbon-carbon double bonds are located. In the one with just one, we have just one number listed there. And when we have no sites of unsaturation in this fully saturated 20-0 fatty acid, we have no locations listed for carbon-carbon double bonds because there aren't any. So taking a look at this and keeping in mind that the saturated fats have the strongest intermolecular interactions, we look through the list for a saturated fat. Right here in the middle, we have our saturated fatty acid with 20 carbon atoms and no carbon-carbon double bonds. The other possible winners or losers, however you want to look at here, have alkene groups. And therefore, this saturated fatty acid with the same number of carbons in the chain as the others is going to rank as having the highest melting point. It's going to be the hardest to disrupt the intermolecular interactions, in other words, to create a liquid out of this solid. We're going to heat it in the oven or something like that to get it to melt. Now we look at our two different alkenes. The exact location of the alkene group does not contribute heavily toward the melting points of these substances. So don't let this be a red herring that leads you astray where you try to overanalyze where the carbon-carbon double bond is. It's the number of carbon-carbon double bonds that plays the biggest role. And so the trend here is that the more carbon-carbon double bonds, the weaker the intermolecular interactions, and hence having two carbon-carbon double bonds is going to make this have the lowest melting point, meaning the weakest intermolecular interactions, and hence the easiest to melt. And then at the other side of the spectrum, or next in line, I should say, at number two, is going to be our unsaturated fatty acid that has just one alkene group residing there between the weakest intermolecular interactions with multiple carbon-carbon double bonds and the strongest intermolecular interactions with no carbon-carbon double bonds. In this problem, let's apply our skills in evaluating intermolecular interactions and melting points and boiling points one more time. Here we're asked which has a higher melting point, a triglyceride originating from 3-10-0 fatty acids as the building blocks, or a triglyceride that incorporates 3-16-0 fatty acids as its building blocks. In this case, the extent of saturation is the same. In both cases, they are a :0 fatty acid, meaning that there are no carbon-carbon double bonds in either of these. So, with that in mind, what we look to as the alternative criteria to distinguish these is the number of carbon atoms, where this has 16, and up here has 10. Now, thinking back to our van der Waals forces and intermolecular interactions, what we saw was that as the carbon chain length increases on alkyl groups, we have increased van der Waals intermolecular interactions. Increased intermolecular interactions lead to an increased boiling point and an increased melting point. And that's the logic that we can apply here toward this type of problem. Applying that toward this problem, that tells us that having the longer carbon chain is going to result in a higher melting point because of the increased intermolecular interactions. So therefore, we can come up to the top here and we can label that this 16-0 fatty acid derived triglyceride is going to have the higher boiling point, or melting point for that matter. The 10-0 fatty acid derived triglyceride is going to have the lower boiling point, or melting point for that matter.